أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم and welcome to another edition of Perspective on ITV. My name is Faizel Patel and inshallah today we have a guest in studio and his name is Zafar Bangash. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Perspective.
Wa alaikum assalam. It's a pleasure.
Jazakallah. Zafar Bangash is a noted Islamic movement journalist and a commentator in Toronto, Canada. He's also director of the Institute of Contemporary Islamic Thought and president of the Islamic Society of York Region, a suburb of Toronto. He's imam at the Islamic Society of York Region's Masjid and Community Center in Richmond Hill, Ontario. He's editor of the Crescent International News Magazine and a trustee and formerly assistant director of the Muslim Institute in London, where he worked with the late Dr. Kalim Siddiqui, the founder of the Muslim Institute and leader of the Muslim Parliament of Great Britain. Bangash is also co-founder of the Muslim Unity Group. He is best known for his commentaries and current affairs as editor of the Crescent International Magazine and continues as columnist and contributor to the Crescent. And we have a pleasure and honor to have him in studio today.
Thank you.
Now, first and foremost, in your article, The Phenomenon and Politics of Sectarianism, dated January 2014. You write, and I quote, "Sectarianism is projected in some quarters as the greatest challenge facing Muslims when the vast majority of Muslims want unity in the Ummah." Now, who is stoking the flames of sectarianism in the world and particularly in Muslim countries?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. First of all, I want to emphasize that although sectarianism is framed in theological terms, it is actually a political problem. Mm-hmm. Unless and until we grasp this point, we are not going to be able to address this issue properly. So when we look at the global situation, we see regrettably that there are problems in different parts of the Muslim world. We have a very serious problem in Syria, another similar crisis in Iraq, in Lebanon, in Afghanistan, Pakistan. In fact, you can just go around the Muslim world. Regrettably, we have very, very serious issues. Now, sectarianism is being used specifically as a tool, unfortunately, by the regime in Saudi Arabia, because they have found that their policies are not working. They were determined to get rid of the regime of Bashar al-Assad. When they saw that their policy was failing, of course, in conjunction with a number of their Arabian allies, that they resorted to this very destructive and negative campaign in which they hurl allegations of takfir against other Muslims, etc. I want to emphasize that I don't sit here as an apologist for the Assad regime or that I am in any way in favor of him. But what I would like to emphasize is that the kind of government or the leader in Syria has to be determined by the Syrian people. We can, of course, offer our moral support to them, and we must. We must offer our full support to the Syrian refugees that are suffering terribly, whether it's inside Syria or outside. And regrettably, what we find is that regimes like those in Saudi Arabia and Qatar, on the one hand, they are spending billions of dollars in stoking sectarianism and arming the various rebel groups. But when it comes to the Syrian refugees, they are not there to offer any help. In fact, what they are indulging in is such disgraceful behavior that it should make every Muslim ashamed, because Saudis and Qataris and other Arab men, old men, they go into these refugee camps, they pick up young Syrian girls, 10, 12 years old, and take them away And many of them, unfortunately, have ended up in prostitution. It's a disgrace for the Muslim Ummah. It should be a great concern to the Muslim Ummah. And we should identify the forces that are trying to stoke sectarianism on the one hand, on the alleged claim that they are supporting the people of Syria. And on the other hand, you see the mistreatment and the horrible behavior towards Syrian girls and Syrian women that are trapped in a very, very tragic situation in these refugee camps.
Now, I'm just worried. We're talking about sectarianism. We're talking about it at a grassroots level. How do we as an ummah, no matter which country you live in, whether it's a non-Muslim country like South Africa or a Muslim country like Saudi Arabia or even Egypt, how do we as Muslims from different sects coalesce to stand united as ummah and take on the, let's say, the Western powers, if you want to put it like that, or to take on people that have created a war declared war in Islam?
Yes. I'm glad that you touched on the situation in South Africa. I mean, let's face it, the South African Muslim population is minuscule compared to the overall population in South Africa. And within that, if you look at, basically when we are talking about sectarianism, we are actually talking about Sunnis and Shias. That's basically what the alleged conflict is supposed to be. Mm-hmm. Now, there are so few Shias in this country that I'm not quite sure exactly why sectarianism should be a problem over here. I mean, what is it? Are the Shias coming to take over the Sunni mosques in this country? Are the Shias coming to somehow convert every African in this country to Shiaism? What is it that people are scared about? And who is it that is injecting this poison into this community? I mean, I think I would like to appeal to your viewers and say, well, look, let's look at it. Is the South African Muslim community facing a sectarian challenge, or there is a very serious drugs problem, even within the Muslim community? Families are falling apart. There are many other challenges that this community faces. Why can't the leaders of this community address those issues all of them, because I know for a fact, I travel across South Africa extensively, I know for a fact that the vast majority of people do not want this kind of a conflict. It is just a tiny minority who are acting at the behest of other people to promote these divisions, which is actually going to cause a lot of damage not only to the Muslim community in South Africa, but worldwide, because this phenomenon is deliberately being stoked. You mentioned other powers, external powers, of course. You know, there is a war going on Islam. America has officially declared war against the Muslims. They call it the war on terror, but it's not the war on terror. We call it the war of terror. Yeah. They're actually terrorizing the Muslim community, the Muslims worldwide. I mean, Muslims pose no threat to anybody. I often, when I participate in debates on television in Canada, I ask them, if you say that Muslims are such a threat to the West, please tell me how many Muslim armies are occupying Western countries. But it's all Western countries whose armies are occupying Muslim lands. Mm-hmm. So aren't Muslims in Afghanistan, for instance, entitled to defend themselves? Aren't Muslims in Syria entitled to defend their own integrity, territorial integrity and their honor, and to be able to choose their own leaders? What about the Muslims in Palestine? They are being oppressed, terrorized for 60, 70 years. Aren't the Palestinian people entitled to defend their rights, their honor, their livelihood? Gaza is a vast prison. Even the British Prime Minister, David Cameron, has admitted that it's a vast prison. Yes. He's no friend of the Palestinian people. Mm-hmm. So we face much bigger issues and bigger challenges in the world. And I will appeal to your viewers that they should look at this thing and refrain from these kinds of divisive rhetoric that is going to serve no purpose as far as Muslims are concerned. One final point that I want to mention, and that is that, or two, number one, that in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually commands us to remain united. For instance, in Surah Ali Imran, he says, وَاَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, that hold fast to the rope of Allah and be not divided. Mm-hmm. And there's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in which he has said, if two people are arguing with one another and one calls another a kafir, and if these both of them claim to be Muslims, that one of them is going to go to hell. So the Sahaba asked the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, please explain, we are not clear about this. So the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if the first person making the allegation against the second one, and if the second one is a kafir, then that person is going to go to hell. But if the person making the allegation is making a false allegation against the second person, then the person making the allegation is going to go to hell. It's a very, very serious responsibility.
Yeah, absolutely.
Muslims must be very careful. We shouldn't be indulging in this kind of thing. We shouldn't be playing the role that belongs exclusively to the domain and authority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So it's an absolutely pertinent topic that we need to obviously discuss, but it's very difficult because every sect, if you want to put it that way, has got a certain different set of ideals yes. that they adhere to. And it's very difficult to sort of, you know, bring them onto your side. But obviously that will be, we can elaborate on that a little further later.
Sure.
Now, you also oppose the United States calling it the greediest, most exploitative, most manipulative, most hypocritical, and most ruthless power that the world has ever known. Can you comment on that?
Absolutely. Let us look at the last 50 years. And let us see, has there been any year in the last 50 or 60 years that the U.S. has not been at war with any country? The record speaks for itself,
absolutely.
Number one. Secondly, the U.S. officially declares that the resources of the rest of the world belong to the U.S. They are, they are part of the U.S.'s national interest.
Okay, Zafar, you oppose the United States, calling it the greediest, most exploitative, most manipulative, most hypocritical, and most ruthless power that the world has ever known. Can you comment on this?
Sure. See, look at the last 50 or 60 years, and let us look at or ask the question, whether is there any year in these 60 years that the U.S. has not been at war with any country or one or another country in the world. Mm-hmm. The U.S. says that other people's resources belong to us. And so in order to grab those resources, although those people are willing to sell their resources to the U.S., but it wants to grab them at minimal cost. And so you see that the U.S. goes around bullying other countries. It goes around occupying other countries. It goes around killing other people. You look at the last 10, 12 years alone, Afghanistan and Iraq, and you see that they have murdered more than 1.5 million people in these, 10, 12 years. So that record speaks for itself. So as I said, it's greedy, it's exploitative, it's an oppressive power, and it does not know how to live in peace with other people.
Okay. We are speaking to Zafar Bangash. We're going to go for a break. And inshallah, when we return, we will continue to speak to him. It's quite interesting and a lot of issues that we need to tackle. Stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Perspective on ITV. Tonight we're speaking to Zafar Bangash. He's a noted Islamic movement journalist and commentator in Toronto, Canada. You're welcome to interact with me by sending me a mail on faizel@itvnetworks.tv. Alternatively, send me a tweet on @faizy143 or on facebook.com/faizelpatel. So, Zafar, before the break, we were speaking about the U.S. and all the atrocities that it has committed on the various nations because of the resources that it wants to scrounge, and I use that word in a very light term. Now, moving further, drones have become the weapons of choice for the United States because no American casualties are involved. Now, if innocents are killed, that is just collateral damage. Why does the U.S. continue its drone strikes despite repeated Pakistani requests?
You see, in your question, there is already the answer is embedded in it, in the sense that the U.S. thinks that since there are no U.S. casualties involved, therefore, if they kill other people, it makes absolutely no difference. Recently, only in the last few months, for instance, in October, the UN Human Rights Organization published a report, and soon thereafter, Amnesty International, as well as Human Rights Watch, issued a combined report regarding U.S. drone strikes, not only in Pakistan, incidentally, in Yemen, in Somalia, and a number of other countries that they are involved in. And according to the figures and statistics that they have released, these two organizations, the UN as well as Amnesty International, they say that the overwhelming majority of the people that are killed in these U.S. drone strikes are civilians. Mm. And the U.S. has a habit of simply sort of saying, well, you know, we targeted suspected militants.
Yeah.
Now, when you use the word suspected militants, There is no proof that they were actually militants. Secondly, let us assume that they were militants. Does that give the U.S. the license to go and kill people? I mean, surely there is something called due process. There is something called international law. Isn't the U.S. Obliged to follow international law as it keeps on pushing other people to follow international law? Let me give you just one episode that occurred in October of 2012. It was actually October 24th. A U.S. drone plane fired two Hellfire missiles in a small village in North Waziristan outside a town called Miransha. And that missile killed a 68-year-old grandmother by the name of Maimuna Bibi. And there were three or four young children near her that were playing. Those children were badly wounded. This elderly lady, 68-year-old woman, was actually collecting vegetables in her small farm because she was going to cook a meal for the children. This was on the eve of Eid al-Adha. Now imagine this poor woman is blown to pieces. And the statement that the U.S. Pentagon issued was that there was a convoy of suspected militants and we actually targeted them. Now, that they claimed that that convoy was going near the house of this family and it was by mistake that this family was killed. Or they didn't even admit that the family, this woman was killed. To this day, they have not admitted it. Number one, according to UN investigation as well as Amnesty investigation, there is no road anywhere near that house whose occupants were targeted. That house sits in the middle of the farms without even a path going to it. Secondly, that poor woman was targeted despite the fact that the drone was flying over that area for several hours. And there were young children, and they could see that these are young children. There was one particular, like, you know, it is so sad that when these children were injured, of course, you know, a three-year-old boy who fell from the roof and he broke almost all bones in his body. And the parents are so poor that they couldn't afford to actually look after this young boy. The family had to make a choice now. They had enough money to treat only one of the children. So two boys and a girl. So the family decides that they're going to treat only the oldest boy, who is 13 years old, because the father felt that he would be of help to me in my work. So imagine a young girl, 8-year-old Nabila, her name was. Yes. She still has shrapnel in her body. She still cannot get treatment because the family is so poor. The young boy, the 3-year-old kid, had his ribs broken, both his arms broken and his legs broken. He couldn't get any treatment because the family is poor. Well, and a poor young boy has permanent deformities now, and he gets nightmares. Okay. And these are the kinds of things that the U.S. is involved in.
Okay. Now, just on that thought, do you think, and this question has been plaguing me for a while, do you think that because the United States is a large supporter or a large donor to the United Nations, do you think the United Nations is obligated to overlook a certain flagrancy by the United States?
Well, that's actually part of the reason. But the other thing is the structure of the United Nations itself. You see, the United Nations is essentially two bodies, although there are other sort of components of it as well, but the two most important components are the Security Council and the General Assembly. So you see, if a vote is passed in the General Assembly, it has moral authority, but it has no enforcement mechanism.
Yes.
The only enforcement mechanism resides in the Security Council. So what did these powers do when, after the Second World War, when they created the United Nations? So you have five permanent members of the Security Council. Anytime a resolution is presented, unless and until these five permanent members of the Security Council, who are also called veto-wielding members,
yes,
which includes the U.S., Russia, China, France, and Britain, if any of them vetoes a particular resolution, no matter, even if all the other 14 members, like there are five permanent and 10 rotating members, even if they all vote for it, that resolution cannot go through. Mm-hmm. So the U.S., because it sits in the Security Council, anytime there is any resolution that is presented against the U.S. or against Israel, I want to add that it's very important.
Absolutely.
There are more than 70 Security Council resolutions that the U.S. has vetoed, which chastise Israel for its flagrant violation of the Palestinians' rights or for breaking international law by invading Lebanon or attacking Egypt or Jordan or a number of other countries. So it is because of the Security Council and its structure that the U.S. gets away with these kinds of egregious crimes. Mm-hmm. But as I had mentioned earlier, there is, for instance, the United Nations Human Rights Body that presented a report. In fact, that is headed by Ben Emerson. He's a very respected barrister in Britain, and he's openly called for some of the U.S. leaders to be tried for war crimes because they are killing innocent people. So, unfortunately, because the way the U.N. is structured, the U.S. is able to get away with all of these terrible, terrible crimes without suffering any of the negative consequences.
Absolutely. You mentioning the U.S., certain people within the U.S. being liable for war crimes. In South Africa as well, last year, the Muslim Lawyers Association issued a warrant for Obama's arrest, you remember correctly, when he came to South Africa as well. So, do you think that that will ever materialize? I mean, can the U.S. be held liable by the world to account for the atrocities they're inflicting upon the world?
Unfortunately not, because the way the global situation is structured. But what can happen and what must continue to happen is that if there are legal experts around the world, that they pass these kinds of resolutions or get court injunctions, then they can make life difficult for some of these U.S. Officials. And of course, they travel around the world. For instance, a few years ago, Donald Rumsfeld, the former Secretary of Defense in Bush administration, he had gone to Paris on a visit. And in fact, the lawyers in Paris had obtained a court injunction to arrest him. So Rumsfeld was forced to travel from the airport in an official or government helicopter to be taken to the Elysee Palace to meet Sarkozy. And then from there, he was taken back to the airport in a helicopter so that these people didn't have an opportunity to serve the arrest warrant on him. So we can embarrass them. We can sort of do some of these things. But unfortunately, as I said, given the current global situation, it is unrealistic to expect that Obama or anybody would be put as war criminals.
I just want to touch on Pakistan again. We're talking about the whole drone attacks. We're talking about Taliban in Pakistan. Do you think that the U.S. and Britain's assistance to Malala Yousafzai was a propagandist act to show the world that the U.S. does have a moral conscience, or Britain does have a moral conscience?
But actually, this was a deliberate ploy because Malala Yousafzai, I mean, you know, I admire her courage and her, you know, campaign to promote women's education. But the manner in which she has allowed herself to be used by Britain, and the manner, I mean, I read her book and I was appalled at some of the statements that she has made in that book. She has no respect for the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. She openly says that her father, when Pakistan was celebrating its 50th year of independence, her father wore a black shirt because they wanted to protest against Pakistan's independence. Yeah. And she has written that perhaps, you know, Pakistan should not even have been made a separate country. It should have remained part of India, as if the plight of Muslims in India is anything good. So, unfortunately, she's being used by the West to advance their own agenda. And it is so ironic, for instance, that while her father, who has a number of schools now, he started with three children in his school, and now he has more than 1,000 children, and he's collecting something like 1,000 rupees per month from each child, and he's living it off. You know, he's having a great time. The campaign that he has joined with Gordon Brown, the former British Prime Minister, this is not to provide free education to children. It is actually to have for-profit schools so that these people would be making money out of them. So they're actually exploiting this issue of education for girls, etc., which is a very noble objective. And they are basically making tons of money out of it. And Malala is basically a tool in their hands, unfortunately. Much as I, you know, sympathize with her effort to get education for children, much as I sympathize that she should not be targeted by anybody, but unfortunately she has allowed herself to be used.
Okay, Bangar, just in a few seconds we got left, your last thoughts and comments to our viewers?
Well, I would come back to your original question with respect to this issue of sectarianism and the conflict that has emerged in the Muslim Ummah, although I'm convinced that this will blow away. It's not going to stay there permanently. Also, whatever views people hold, they are more than welcome to it, provided those views are based on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as well as we can bring authentic sources to prove our point of view. But at the same time, that does not give us the right that we start to condemn other Muslims as kafirs, etc. This is a very, very serious thing, and people should be very careful about it.
We've come to the end of another edition of Perspective. Join me again next week, inshallah, where we have more stories for you making national, international, and local headlines. And you're welcome to interact with me by sending me a tweet on at Faizel143 or a mail at faizel@itvnetworks.tv or on facebook.com/Faizel Patel. For myself, Faizel Patel, and the great team here at ITV, fi amanillah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى صرت في ظرف عصيب فاكشف البلوى فيا ربي أنا عبد لرد الطيم لا يقوى أعني ربي في أمري.